Welcome to The Microscopists, a bite-sized bio podcast, hosted by Peter O'Toole, sponsored by Zeiss Microscopy. Today on The Microscopists...
Today on The Microscopists, I'm joined by John Erickson from University of Turku and Eurobioimaging, and he explains the moment he fell in love with microscopy.
I was going with my samples. I'd never done a fluorescence microscopy before. I was going there, and first time I looked into the microscope, it was like, wow, amazing. This is, you know, this is the reason.
Talks about his favorite cities.
I don't know if you've been to Chicago, but it's such a cool place. It has jazz, a lot of music, classical music, Chicago Symphony Orchestra, lots of playhouses, a fantastic place.
And doesn't hold back from sharing his caffeine intake.
In the morning, minimum 1 liter of tea, then 2 espressos, and then maybe a Coke Zero or something. So that's my sort of morning peak.
All in this episode of The Microscopists. Hi, welcome to The Microscopists. I'm Peter O'Toole, and today I'm joined by John Erickson, Director General of Eurobioimaging and Professor of Cell Biology, I think it is, John, at Turku University. How are you today, John?
Pretty good, Peter, and thanks a lot for the invite. And I must say congratulations to a great podcast, because we have many members in the team who are big fans of the podcast.
That's lovely to hear. Thank you. I don't know where to start on this one. I'm going to maybe start. Director General is quite a grand name for the Eurobioimaging side. What does it entail?
So the title is fancy, I agree. And I must say that looking back on my career and your nice invitation made me check out a little bit. So why did I become this and that? But one thing, when I was as an undergraduate student, I was pretty sure, or especially now in retrospective, I could not imagine that one day I would become Director General, because the title itself is quite pompous. Director General is quite typical in EU circumstances when you have an organization which is big or even not so big, but that's the title that is being used. Being Director General in my case means that I'm responsible for an organization that has the ERIC format, and the ERIC format has been created by the Commission in order to enable this kind of international organizations to work a little bit easier in the landscape of different countries. So we have a jurisdiction which is making our life a little bit easier. But difference, for example, with a university department or something like that, institute, that we are not under the umbrella of any organization, but we are actually, one could say that we are a special purpose company, obviously non-profit. And legally, as Director General, I'm responsible for that organization. And then, of course, I'm doing lots of other things, but that is maybe the indication of the title in terms of the EU landscape, that there's somebody who is responsible.
So I think a really good question at this point. You did your undergraduate. You've obviously gone to be a very successful academic career. Why even want to be Director General of Eurobioimaging? Because it's quite a significant role. It's not primary research per se. So what was your motivation to move into that position?
I think, as it often is in life, and I think you're familiar with that, as most of us who have a little bit experience behind us, life is quite serendipitous. And 10, 15 years ago, I could never have imagined that there would be this opportunity. But this arose by many different factors, and one thing led to the other. And I hope we can sort of elucidate this process during our discussion, because actually everything is based on something leading, one thing leading to the next one. But everything is rather random, rather serendipitous. And it was not like I was aiming for being director general 10, 15 years ago. I had no idea that this possibility would come to me. And but it came, and I took the opportunity. But I think it may be better to come to that part of the story with a little bit of background.
I'm going to go way back then, way back. Oh, by the way, when you said it's both of us with a bit of experience behind us, I love the way you subtly both called us old in that. I thought that was quite cool. I thought I'm going to keep that one in my mind. If we go back, I'm going to take you back before you did your undergraduate. I'm going to take you back to when you were, I don't know, 8, 10, 12 years of age. Can you remember what the first career was that you actually wanted to be, whether it be a footballer, a scientist, or an astronaut, or whatever it was? Can you remember the first job that you really fancied being?
First job, chef.
Chef?
Yeah. I always liked making food. But I very soon realized that that's a very tough job. When I became a little bit older, a few years older, I was interested in a lot of things. So I was crazy about books and reading and so forth. So I dreamed about becoming an author or a journalist. And actually, in high school, I was working kind of freelance from time to time in weekend editions of a local newspaper. So I wrote pieces there, and then I was in the fancy editorial board of our school journal, which translates something into the blurb. Mm-hmm. But I was also very interested in natural sciences and also biology a lot. And actually, I liked microscopes, which came into my career much later, but I liked the microscopes of our school so much so. I offered to fix them and clean them and align them all. They were very, very basic, you know, this kind of like 1920s, something like that, that they have recovered from some hospital or something. But I had them at home over summer, and I thought it was very nice to have microscopes at home. So that... then I went to university, and I liked too many things. So biology, ecology, cell biology, chemistry, computer science. So I spent, I'm sure, at least two more extra years just reading many things and so forth. So it took me a while also to decide what should I become, what should I make out of my life, because I liked chemistry a lot. I liked ecology, but I also loved physiology. So, but of course, the concept of being on some research vessel somewhere, having a cold beer and saving the world, that was, you know, coming from Jacques Cousteau and those movies that were very popular in those days.
Did you ever get onto a ship, a research ship?
I actually worked at the end of my undergraduate studies. I worked in a limnology project for a while. And again, by pure chance, that sort of served me a PhD project, which took me right into cell biology. And pure chance again.
So you did a PhD. So did you know when you were a PhD student that you wanted to be an academic, or were you just doing a PhD because you enjoyed research, or did you see a different career ahead of you at that stage?
I was open for both academic and also maybe some other direction, even governmental, but maybe not so much in the corporate area, so something like that. But I think as I was learning things during my PhD, I got more and more inspired by the academic life, I must say.
So where actually go back, where was your undergraduate and where was your PhD?
So I did my undergraduate here in Turku, and we have two universities here. We have University of Turku, and then we have Åbo Akademi University, and I did it in the latter. And now I've been working in both universities, actually, as a professor in my career when I had the chance of becoming a professor.
But have you been in Turku all your life? Or
no. I've been here as an undergraduate and graduate student. Then I went to Chicago for almost 4 years. Then I came back. But then when working in Turku, I've been living between 3 or 4 blocks. So very, very local person.
How was that? So what was the move to Chicago? What stage was that? Was that postdoctoral or first?
That was postdoc. That was postdoc.
How did you find that move?
I must say, Chicago was super nice. It was really, really an excellent move. It was an excellent choice. And again, the choice was rather fun in terms of how it came around. So I could go a little bit back before I go to Chicago, because the story behind that is related to my topic. And I can define almost by the day when I saw the light in terms of microscopy. So this was somewhere in 1987 or something. So I'll go back to the limnology part a little bit. So I was an undergraduate student finishing up my master's thesis. Everybody is doing a master's here, which was on fish physiology. But then I took a job to collect samples in a limnology project. And I got quite inspired, and maybe that this would be my future. We were working on water reservoirs on the Åland Islands, which are between Finland and Sweden. And they were heavily, heavily polluted with cyanobacteria, blue-green algae. And lots of dead birds and fish, dead fish in the summer. That's not nice to have in a water reservoir. And I realized that there was data on toxic algae from way back in the 1800s. The first paper in Nature, 18 something, I don't remember, 70 maybe. But I also realized that the toxins there were not characterized at all in those days. So I was discussing with my mentor, who is a limnologist, that perhaps I'm more interested in moving into this area of toxin research. So it came, the opportunity of changing direction a little bit. And we wrote grants, and we got grants. And of course, the topic was quite easy to get grants on, because water reservoirs are obviously of interest. So cut the long story short, I managed to isolate these peptides, and there were other groups also working on this topic in the world. And many reports came along approximately at the same time. These were cyclic peptides. And you may know that, cyclic peptides are, it's a peculiar type of peptides. They're very stable because of the cyclic form. And they have usually an alteration with D and L type of amino acids. And these peptides were super cool because chemically, I had a strong chemistry background. So I spent at least a year just on the chemistry and isolating this. But then it turned out that these are super toxins. So they're amazingly powerful. So LD50 is in the order of 50 microgram, meaning that you put one microgram in a mouse and it will die. So the first experiments we did, we put the mice to sleep, injected the toxin, and the liver explodes. I mean, literally. So they die by internal bleeding. So they're very soon it became obvious that this is liver specific. And that was because of a transport mechanism that the liver cells has, bile acid transport, which is a route for many toxins, actually. So then I went ahead trying to figure out what is the background. And I tested all the possible possibilities in terms of molecular toxicology that were around in those days with calcium metabolism, redox states, ion transport, but nothing. They were alive, the cells. Nothing happened to the cells in terms of trypan blue uptake and so forth. And then comes this moment of light. And that was sort of triggering my pathway into microscopy. So somebody told me that at some stage we can have a look on the on the pictures, but somebody told me that why don't the cells are looking quite wrinkled when you look in the microscope, that there is this compound phalloidin which is rhodamine labeled. Why don't you stain the cells with that? And I realized that phalloidin labeling was super easy. I mean, also currently it's very easy compared to many antibodies because it's always working if you don't screw up. And we had one reasonable microscope in the building. It had a 40x lens, epifluorescence microscope, and I was going with my samples. I'd never done a fluorescence microscopy before. I was going there, and first time I looked into the microscope, it was like, wow, amazing. This is, you know, this is the reason. There's everything that is happening in the liver is because the cytoskeleton is completely screwed up. So that made me a true believer in microscopies, that one should always check in the microscope. That's the first thing you do. And you use all the basic stuff that is around, and then you will always get lots of information.
John, do you still have those images, those first images?
So because of your invitation, I was looking in my old cabinets, and I found the first pictures that I took with those that I mentioned.
Nope.
It's the first pictures. They were two round cells. Yeah, no, that's the next one. Two. Oh. Yeah, there we are. So I don't know if you've ever worked with liver cells, but you can work with isolated liver cells. You perfuse the liver with collagenase and first flush with EGTA, so you snap up the desmosomes, and then collagenase, and then the liver cells are released, and then you can work with them for a day approximately. They're, of course, in the suspension, so they're not under the normal conditions. But this is how, at the left side, this is how the microfilaments will look like. They're sort of cortically distributed, no stress fibers, nothing right. like that.
They're nicely structured around the membrane itself.
Yeah, so that's one liver cell. And then the one on the right-hand side is treated with microcystin, which is the toxin. So nanomolar levels and the microfilaments are completely moved to one part of the cell.
You know what's fascinating? For those that are listening, you've got a nice image which looks a bit like the sun with a bright edge to it. And then you've got another cell where actually all that intensity is bunched up together and bulging out to one side. It isn't just disrupted, but it's also relocated. The whole change of distribution. And I kind of expected when you were talking about it for the distribution to sort of just become loose and just stop binding. But actually, no, it seems to have almost aggregated into a mass. Is that what happened?
Yeah, so that is a long story, but that's my story, the story of my PhD. So first of all, I realized that that this is a cytoskeletal element or event. And the reason why the liver explodes is that these cells cannot keep themselves together anymore because all the interactions obviously will be destroyed. At that time, I was not super proficient with the cytoskeleton, but the I thought that, okay, I discovered phalloidin or cytokalasin or something, cytoskeletal disruptor. So I went to Uno Lindberg's lab in Stockholm. They were very good with microfilaments, and I was hoping that we could show that, okay, microfilaments are being aggregated or polymerization is disturbed. Nothing, absolutely nothing. So then we could actually have a look on the electron micrographs if that were there. Yeah, so these are micrographs that I was collaborating with a group in Dundee.
So a great looking tennis ball one healthy cell, and then actually quite a smooth surface, but a very, very, what would be the word? It is just bulging everywhere, isn't it?
Yeah, it's always collected, this rosette of blebs at one part of the cell. And that's where you have the actin cytoskeleton. And there's a transmission EM also. Yeah, there we are.
Oh, that just makes it look like my head's exploding.
Yeah. So you can see the ring there. And that's the actin ring that we were looking at in the fluorescence.
That's incredible. So that's three different microscopy technologies coming together just to resolve the one question.
And all of this got me completely hooked on microscopy because, as you can realize, as you're a microscopist, to get these pictures, I've stayed quite a few hours in different dark rooms, listening to various music, and I'm completely hooked to that kind of working environment, and also primed, I guess.
John, how often do you get on a microscope now?
Last time in 2014. So a little bit depressing, I must say.
I was going to say, do you remember what your first fluorescence microscope was?
So that's that's a Leica microscope, if advertising is okay here. But we used, afterwards, we have almost all the major brands here. But I don't remember the actual model, but it was a very basic model. And
but what about TMs? What about TM and SEM? Do you remember what they were?
So the SEM was Geo 1200, well, yeah, 1200. And the transmission was a very basic Geo. Mm-hmm. And I wouldn't say the number, but really basic.
Yeah.
But giving pretty good pictures, I must say.
No, I certainly remember my first microscopes. And I'd be hard pushed to say what my favorite was, though, over the time, because you got a soft spot for most, I think.
Yeah.
I'm going through.
And they're so great machines, and nowadays they are amazing. But they were amazing in those days also, a little bit more tricky, but finicky, but great machines.
So why Chicago?
Okay. So now we come to the mechanism. What happened with these structures? So the whole basis of this this cytoskeletal disruption is that we discovered that the microcystin acts as a phosphatase inhibitor. So you may be familiar with okadaic acid and calicolin, which are inhibiting type 1 and type 2A phosphatases. And the reason for the cytoskeletal disruption is inhibition of protein phosphatases. And as we now know, you know, the balance of any phosphorylation event is the balance between the kinase activity and the phosphatase activity. And here you shut off the phosphatases altogether, and the cytoskeleton gets completely screwed up. And to me, that was a revelation, because I always thought of phosphorylation events as, you know, a little bit static. So the kinase is activated, something is moved into another direction, and then the phosphatase takes back. But I realized that the cytoskeleton is then much more of like a helicopter that is balanced by these activities, and it then you move the joysticks of the cell and things will move in different directions. When we were doing in vivo labeling with P32 phosphate, we realized that intermediate filaments, the keratins in liver cells, the keratin 8 and 18 are the specific intermediate filaments of liver cells. And then I decided to do my postdoc on intermediate filaments, because I was curious about intermediate filaments. They were much less known than microfilaments and microtubuli. And there was, I got an interview with Bob Goldman, who worked at and still works at Northwestern University. And I got an interview, and then I decided to go to Chicago. And that was a fantastic decision.
So were you daunted by the thought of it to start with? Just excited? How is your sort of personal feelings about leaving Finland, going to quite a different culture over in New York?
I had no problem. I had absolutely no problem. I was just like my future wife. We were adventurers. We had a few interviews in the United States. We went there interviewing, and I was actually supposed to interview with Bob Goldman, but he had screwed up his calendar. So I was there, he was not there. And I thought that, okay, forget about this guy. I will take the other offer I had in Princeton. But then he called me up a little bit later and said, John, why are you not here? You should be on an interview. I was there 2 weeks ago, but you were not there. And he said that, okay, sorry about that. My secretary screwed up my calendar. He always put the blame on
blame someone else.
And then I went for another interview, and we got along very well. And I decided to go there. And I don't know if you've been to Chicago, but it's such a cool place. It has jazz, a lot of music, classical music, Chicago Symphony Orchestra, lots of playhouses, a fantastic place. And the science is great. So you have both University of Chicago and Northwestern University, lots of different opportunities. I was completely blown away by this city and everything else. And of course, I had been working under very sort of limited circumstances, and suddenly I'm moving in this very international environment, and you realize that you're a very small fish in a big sea, which is humbling and nice because it gives you perspective. And the lab was also great, wonderful people, wonderful colleagues, super helpful. There were people who taught me so much in protein chemistry, and of course cell biology in terms of instrumentation compared to the one old Leica I had. Bob Goldman had everything that you could have in those days, so, and he got one of the first confocal microscopes, so that was a Zeiss microscope if I'm not mistaken, and so I got to see a confocal microscope very early on. And also thanks to this postdoc, I was staying two summers at the Woods Hole Marine Biological Laboratory, which you may have. There are also many, many famous scientists to be, you know, going out for a beer with, and are going for quite amazing parties when the cell cycle was being drawn on the beach because Tim Hunt was there. And then there was Shinya Inoue, who is, of course, absolutely amazing. So lots of amazing people, lots of amazing instruments, and skinny dipping among fluorescent algae and what have you.
And did you say you went over with your wife-to-be at the time?
Yes.
And what was she, did she find a job over there as well? Was she also studying?
Yes. So my wife is a molecular biologist and molecular geneticist, and she worked with Rick Morimoto in the Evanston campus of Northwestern University. So I worked at the medical school downtown. And Rick Morimoto is a stress biologist. So he has been working, and one of the founding fathers of the stress response. And Lea Siston and my wife is still working with the stress response, just like I'm still working with the intermediate filaments.
That's kind of cool. So then you went back to Philip. Why do you always think you'd go back home?
I think we were both tempted to stay, but then in terms of family and so forth, life may be easier here in Scandinavia. Having a family in the US, we felt that it's quite challenging, but we were tempted to stay. But we got a nice offer, both of us at the same time, at a place which is here in the same building where I'm now, which is called Turku Bioscience Center. And that was a rather visionary place because it was a core facility for both universities. And the idea was to combine both research and core facilities in the same department. And it's a big success. More than 200 people working there now. And that was the whole place was the basis of core facility activities here in Turku. And quite early on, before open access was really well defined.
Yeah.
So we got positions there, and I got a position as a cell biologist, which meant that I should set up all the instruments needed for cell biology. At the time, there was an old Nikon, really crappy, the change was pretty depressing, you know, coming from.
I wonder what it'd be like going from a very extremely well resourced lab back to, you know, not everywhere can be like that, can it?
No, and of course that was my task, to build up a facility that was well equipped. But we came in right after the building was finished, So my lab didn't even have a sink. So that was, it took some time to set up everything.
So out of your career today, what would you say has been the hardest time? What's been the most difficult time?
So then I was working at Turku Bioscience Center for a few years, and that was fun. We managed also to pull in quite a lot of funding for the instruments. But then I, of course, had to apply for professorships. I became professor professor in zoology, actually, at University of Turku in 1998. And that was a teaching position. So I was, of course, allowed to do research and so forth, and even supposed to do that. But the contact hours were more than 200, or easily 250 hours per year. So that was so much. And then I was in the matriculation examination board of Finland, which means the general examination after high school mm-hmm. for everybody. And I was also in the committee evaluating the high school students, you know, their papers. So I got 4,000 papers every Easter. And that was like crazy. So, and then I was running a lab and doing all kinds of things. And also I was quite active in terms of campus administration, and we had small kids. And the nights were very, very short. So I think I looked pretty crappy at times.
So how did you pull yourself back from that?
So then 2006, there was an opportunity to get another professorship, which was much more attractive. And that was at the same time I became head of cell biology, head of department. I got a nice startup package, really nice. And so hundreds of thousands of euros. And I put all of that into microscopes. And I was teaming up with Pekka Hänninen, who is still here, the dean of the medical faculty. And together we bought Leica Matrix SP8, and then we also bought an SP8 stead. And so with that, Turku suddenly became quite strong in Finland, and we became well recognized. And also at that time, we did a kind of coordination thing, which was a good idea. So we were thinking with a few people here that how could we make Turku stronger without taking away anything from anybody else? So we would think about what are our real strongholds. And microscopy was one, because Stefan Hell was working here at the time, actually, when I was recruited back. And so we had this tradition. And then we have also still one of the biggest PET centers in Europe. So we decided to combine these strongholds in a regional organization, which was really a virtual organization to begin with, Turku Bioimaging. And Turku Bioimaging took in everything from microscopy to molecular analysis to even clinical imaging. And so our motto was from atoms to anatomy. And that's a very similar motto as in neurobiomaging, which we, of course, didn't know about in these days. So that the organization started with half a coordinator, and it was amazingly successful. We immediately became much more successful in terms of funding. We got the national coordination of imaging in Finland. Thanks to the national coordination, there's an organization called BioCenter Finland, which is for infrastructures. And I became the coordinator in that organization of imaging. And we got a big chunk of funding, not only for Turku, but for Finland, for Turku, Helsinki, Kuopio, Tampere, and Oulu to improve imaging. And that became the sort of start of the national imaging organization. This brings me to Euroimaging, because there was no national 1-800 imaging in Finland. And so if people were looking for somebody who would be coordinating Finnish imaging, it would be my number. And that's how I got to know Jan Ellenberg, who you have had on your podcast. And he had a very nice, and also Antje Kepler, who is currently nowadays my colleague, was telling about the history and the early beginnings of Euroimaging. But I, quite early on, I got engaged with Euroimaging, which was a project in those days, European project. Yep. And there were two preparatory phases before the organization came to reality. So in those days, I was coordinating the soon-to-be Finnish Euroimaging node. And then, thanks to that, I got to be on the Euroimaging board. And then, you know, things were moving along slowly. But that took quite a long time before the organization came into reality. And some parts of the process were quite slow. But to cut a long story really, really short, it wasn't decided to be, in the beginning, to be a tripartite hub or headquarters. But due to several political circumstances, there was nobody who would take the seat, and seat is the legal body. And because of these circumstances, Finland came into the picture, and Finland is often a nice place to have this kind of legal bodies, because Finland is considered to be neutral and harmless. And then now we have a tripartite headquarters, with the seat, the legal organization, being in Turku. And then we have biological imaging in Heidelberg, in EMBL, and Antje Kepler is the director there. And then we have medical imaging in Torino, where we have Linda Chaban. Wonderful colleagues, both of them, absolutely amazing colleagues. And then also we have a wonderful team. But I was skipping a little bit of history there.
No, that's okay. I'm going to ask you a quick one. Do you regret any of the steps?
Well, I don't know. I don't think I regret anything. So I was dabbling with quite a few. I was dabbling with quite a few things in the beginning, you know, as an undergraduate student. So I could maybe have done a little bit fewer, but, you know, it's okay.
Yeah, no, I think that's probably given you the breadth that's probably helped as you've gone forward. I asked what you wanted to be when you were 10. You sort of said a chef, and then you saw your career, and we've heard how the careers serendipitously got you to where you are today. But if you could do any job in the world for a day or a week, just to see what it's like, is there a job that you'd just like to go and sample? It doesn't have to be in science. It could be any type of job. What would you like to do for a day or a week?
I don't know. I would be a scientist. I know it's a boring answer, but, you know, I'm quite a diehard now.
No, that's okay.
Yep.
Okay. Where would you choose if you could go anywhere in the world and practice your science for 6 months? Where would you go?
That's a hard one, because there are so wonderful places around the world nowadays compared to when I was younger, and also I guess when you're much younger than I am, but even when you were in your early career, I don't know, there are several places in the United States, maybe going into the Boston area would be very, really cool. But also London would be nice.
John, York is so much better than London.
Okay.
If you're going to come to the UK, go do York. It's obvious. Some quick fire questions for you. Are you an early bird or a night owl?
I'm really a night owl. But now I'm often forced to be an early bird. So that's a little bit of a clash there.
PC or Mac?
PC.
McDonald's or Burger King?
There's a Finnish company called Hesburger.
Okay. That's a good answer. Chicago or Turku?
I would take turns, because I consider that both cities are my hometowns. So, for several years I was homesick for Chicago, especially in the fall. Chicago fall is beautiful.
I've got to say, I can see why you're director general. These are politically very nice answers. You're not alienating anyone. Tea or coffee?
Both. Enormous quantities.
So you're caffeine.
I'm so addicted to caffeine. So Johann Sebastian Bach, he has a cantat, a choral for coffee. And I understand why, because that's a magic potion right there. In the morning, minimum 1 liter of tea, then 2 espressos, and then maybe Coke Zero or something. So that's my sort of morning peak. But then I can manage quite a long time with that.
Okay. Beer or wine?
Again, I must say, I'm not trying to be politically correct, but I like both.
Anything.
I'm not so into hard liquor, but I really like beer, especially nowadays when you have all these nice microbreweries and so forth.
Okay.
But of course, a wonderful glass of wine.
Red or white?
Is good. White. And that's maybe because I like red wine also, but if I'm a little excited or stressed, then red wine gives me stomach problems.
Okay. Chocolate or cheese?
What was the first one?
Chocolate or cheese?
I like cheese a lot, and chocolate at times, but maybe I would put cheese first.
Okay. And what is your, you're a chef, what is your favorite food to eat, first off?
Oh, gosh, these questions are hard, because it all depends on the occasion and the season. I like Italian food a lot, but...
Okay.
But, like, right now, here in Finland, it's time for blinis, if you know this.
No.
And these Russian pancakes made of buckwheat, and you eat those with fish roe and pickled cucumbers and stuff. It's great.
Okay. Do you have a least favorite food?
If I have an elite baby.
Least. What is there any food you don't particularly like?
Oh, there are a few, but I'm... Well, I'm sure challenging foods that I couldn't take, but I can take most things.
Okay. I think I know this answer from what you said earlier, but TV or book?
well, I I get to see TV rarely. I like movies, old movies and classical movies. And some of the new TV series are amazing, I must admit.
So what's been your latest TV series?
Babylon Berlin.
Okay. And
check it out. But I'm warning, it's seriously addictive.
It sounds good. And what's your favorite film then?
That would be Citizen Kane and Casablanca.
Two good films. And what about a favorite Christmas film?
A beautiful, what is that? A Beautiful Year? Well, you know the movie.
I don't, but I will find it.
Yeah.
And if you had to choose between one Star Trek
or A Beautiful Life.
A Beautiful Life. A Wonderful Life.
Wonderful Life. There you go. Yes.
Yeah. No, I'm there. Star Trek or Star Wars?
I never, they came in a period when I was so immersed in studies and other things, so I didn't watch them.
So neither on that.
Yeah.
Favorite color?
Kind of bluish.
Bluish.
Yeah.
See, why didn't you just say dappy?
I don't know if it would be dappy though. Maybe maybe Hoekstra rather.
3-3-3-4-2 Yes. what other hobbies do you have? You sent me a picture actually of a. Actually, this just makes it look like I've got loads of hair now, a bit like a werewolf. But is this your pet dog?
That's our Lapland Shepherd. Mm-hmm. And there's a story around that. Apart from this guy, hobbies, I'm an all-year biker, which in Finnish conditions can be quite challenging, but I really like biking. I try to read. I play squash every Monday at 5 o'clock. Since 1983 or something. And then movies and stuff. But as scientists, we don't have so much time for hobbies. But the guy there at the back, he's my mentor. So you can realize from my small history, I've been director for quite a few years. So I was first chair of the department. And then actually in 2016, I became chair or head of the Turku Bioscience Center. And as that is a big place with a big budget and more than 200 people, it was really challenging because I was interim director at Euromanaging, part of the same time. And then I became director of Euromanaging. And being a director is really fun also. And it's very rewarding because you realize that you can do things and change things. So that's my, driving force. But it can be, sometimes the blues hits you big time. Because of funding circumstances, or you have some fight with some colleague or something. And of course, with big institutions, you always have conflicts, and that's the name of the game. But this guy is teaching me the basic truth. Every morning he gets up and always happy. Okay, let's go out. Life is good. And so that's a simple advice, and it's a great advice.
That is super cool, actually. Here, guys, not quick fire question, but what's your favorite conference?
The Gordon Conference on Intermediate Filaments.
That's your favorite conference, okay?
And also,
go on.
Yeah. Yes, well, I haven't been on so many ELMI conferences, but ELMI is super cool.
which of course you hosted.
Oh. And two years ago? Not last year, but the year before.
Yeah, 2 years ago. Only it seems really recent, though. It was an excellent helmet as well. Well done on hosting. That was a great location. Love to see Turku. That was great.
Yeah, and also previous year, these two, because we have been coming out of COVID, they were absolutely fantastic.
So we were asked about the hard times and those difficulties. You just alluded to there, the politics and everything else. With your current role with Eurobioimaging, are there still a lot of politics to navigate, or is it now much easier sailing? I know, listening to Jan, it was terribly, awfully political. But have things now got better, or are the politics still something you have to navigate?
In big international organizations, you always have the political aspect, but it's completely different. So that time that Jan was describing, and he and other people, including Antje, who was aboard did a great job. But those times were really challenging. Now, when the organization was formally accepted as a European organization, that was at the turn of the year 2019-2020, we didn't realize how tough it was just to set up an organization. But politically, it was not so tough anymore. It was, the board meetings were getting much more easy. They're not, we always, the board is, of course, owning us, the member states. So the board meetings are always exciting. But once we got through the period, and that's our first five-year period of establishing the organization, all kinds of recruitment, setting up systems, now we are in our next phase. So going from build-up to strategic development, it's completely different. We have an amazing situation. I must say, I'm sort of mesmerized each morning. We are well-resourced. We have a fantastic node community. We have a 191 sites around Europe. I cannot imagine that anybody of us here in the hub will have a chance to meet, to go to all of these places. But it's an unbelievably nice community. And I see that we can do miracles in the next few years. Also because we start to learn what we really can do. So we can do things that were completely beyond our imaginations when we were in the preparatory phase. So now, as we say, sometimes in the virtual pub, which we have every Friday, which is a community meeting, that we sometimes say that, you know, the sky is the limit, but not the resolution. And that's how I feel the future of Eurobioimaging.
And we are really close to the hour now already. So I have to ask you, this is an interesting question. When you retire, will you carry on going into a lab? Or will you, when you retire, will you enjoy a bit more squash, cycling and shipping at home?
So I hope to do science still when I'm retired, but of course I will shift focus also a little bit and do things that I haven't done before or haven't had time to do. That's for sure, but I haven't thought so much about that.
So there's plenty of time still. It's just an interesting question. There's always one. Some people will cut and go.
Yeah.
Others like to stay in regardless, and it's...
Yeah, I have a hard time envisioning myself, you know, just closing the door saying, bye-bye, this is it.
It'll be different. And do you see Eurobioimaging and Global Bioimaging? Is there any potential one day that they will merge and it will just become Eurobioimaging within Global Bioimaging?
Well, they are sort of sister. Global Bioimaging is a project. Eurobioimaging is an organization. But if we call them projects. They are sister projects, and how that will develop in the future, I think it's for us to see. Obviously, Antje is there leading that the global bioimaging, and part of the team members are very active there. And then the global bioimaging also has its own team. But I think we'll see how it goes. What will be the best arrangement? But there's no discrepancy. There's nothing conflicting there. Both are sort of feeding into each other, and there's a very close relationship.
Well, it'll be interesting to see, I think, in a few years' time, just where everything has got to. John, we have done the hour now.
So okay.
Thank you so much for joining me. Everyone who's been listening, thank you for listening or watching on the podcast. Don't forget to subscribe to the channel. And actually, it's been great. John's already name-dropped Antje Kepler, Stefan Helm, Jan Ellenberg, all previous guests on the microscopy. So you can go back and hear far more details and also about their backgrounds and their inspirations. But John, thank you very much. I know you've been struggling with a cough as well. So thank you very much for getting through that hour.
No worries. We managed well without coughing.
John, thank you very much.
Thanks so much.
Thank you for listening to The Microscopists, a bite-sized bio podcast sponsored by Zeiss Microscopy. To view all audio and video recordings from this series, please visit bitesizebio.com/the-microscopists.